Let the church say amen.
Amen.
In the book of John, the 11th chapter. Taking our reading beginning at the 20th verse. If you love the Lord, say amen.
Amen.
Book of John, the 11th chapter. Gospel. Beginning at the 20th verse and concluding with the 26th verse. I want you to look over to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good
morning. It's good to be found in the Lord's house. These words are found in the 20th verse. Then as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met with him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, that sounds like some faith. Whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am. Look here, Martha. I am the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She said unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, which come into the world. I'm going to stop right there. The Lord had a blessing to the readers to hear his and to do what he has done. Word. Give honor to the Lord our God, to our Savior Jesus the Christ. Thank God for Jesus. And to the Holy Spirit, our guider and our comforter. To my friend, Minister Harris Antoine. So happy to have him, as always, in our midst. My brother, Landry, coming in. Thank God for you as well, and for all of you. I need your prayers with me and for me as I consider this text and using this subject. Tell me why. Why did you let them die? Why did you let them die? The Lord told me to tell you that he heard every prayer. Saw the slowly forming and falling every tear. He saw every time you quietly slipped away from the world, from your family, when you separated yourself from your friends, and even in the midstream, change of schedule, so that you might steal away in a quiet and dark place in order to mourn, grieve, and to pray. Yes. Every accelerated heartbeat, each time your breath quickens, and even the totality of the time that your life spent on Eve. Yes, he tells me. I was there, and I felt the pain. Not just the pain of Martha and Mary, as it registered in the spirit over the dying and the death of their brother Lazarus. Mm-hmm. But he tells me in the spirit there are some mothers and Mary in the congregation today.
What?
Who even after years have passed, are still mourning the absence, the death of their loved ones. He notes to me that he has been there the whole time. He knows that even though some of you have traversed some years and have gotten beyond certain stages of grief, still there are moments, not just on holidays, but on other occasions, where your mind reflects and goes back to loved ones who no longer walk on this side. He has not forgotten how much you cried. He has not forgotten the depth of your sorrow. He has not forgotten how at times your faith has run dry because you miss being able to call mother on the phone, being able to dial up your brother or your sister, being able to hear your son or your daughter laughing. He knows there's a spot in your life, even today, that is blank, desolate, and empty. And whether you say it out loud or not, whether you tell somebody or not, in truth, there are times when the grief is so hard and the burden is so heavy. But you really want to just ask God, why did you let him down? Martha cried. Mary cried. He said, Daddy, I could hear them pray. All of them. All of you. Me too. Daily I can hear them pray, and those who have a lot of faith seem to pray expecting to those which had no faith prayed out of courtesy to those that they loved. I even heard some with extraordinary faith pray. They prayed this prayer, not my will, but thy will be done. He said, I heard such prayer said. Yet there are times when the deepest, darkest of moments,
the devil will come and whisper and talk to you in your sadness.
And he will tell you that if there was a real God and he was a God of love, he never would have let Lazarus die. If you had had a relationship with him like you should have, then you could have just asked, because the Bible says, ask what you will, but it also says, in my name. It says, knock and the door shall be opened unto you. What I'm trying to help you to understand is, don't get the Bible twisted. You can't just ask God for anything and expect just because you ask, God is going to supply you. I wish I had somebody who was praying up enough and somebody and saved isn't always a young man, you know. Sometimes Lazarus can be a job. Sometimes Lazarus can be a relationship. Sometimes Lazarus can be a financial setup. Sometimes Lazarus might be your good health. Sometimes Lazarus might be something else. And how many know God will let Lazarus die? I think about my members. Stella, Cynthia, Eleanor Henderson, Maude Brown. I think about not only those who are members of our church, but members in our community. Just recently I heard that Pastor Cheatham passed.
Yes.
I think about children died. How many remember the young boy that died in Live Oak? He was burned because they couldn't get him out before the fire. Burned down. Sister Petrie, I have to ask, must admit to myself, that sometimes I have to ask God, why you let this? Why did you let them die? Well, God is ready and willing to respond to every prayer. Listen to what he told me in my spirit. As I stood there in the spirit, along with Martha, looking at Jesus. And in Martha, I could see discouragement. In Martha, I could see a struggling faith. In Martha, I could see her sadness. I could hear her saying, I don't understand why it took so long. Because when we contacted you, our brother was already gravely ill. If you loved it, you should have made a way. You should have hastened your steps. But the record is recorded that Jesus stayed 2 more days before he made his way to their house. Lazarus died. Let's talk a little bit about this death. I know this is not a funeral, but I just have to tell you what the Spirit of the Lord has laid in my heart to speak to the church this morning. God spoke to me as I listened in to Jesus and Mary conversation. And he said to me, he said, preacher, you see, man can never be God. No. I need you to pause and think about this in the perspective of this message. Man can never, ever be God. One of the reasons why man can never be God is because man can never handle the pressure.
Amen.
Yeah.
Being God. The pressure alone would drive him crazy. The pressure alone would send him out of his mind. The pressure alone would make him throw in the towel and beg me to come back and be who I am. 151,600 deaths occur every day. 151,600 deaths occur every day. There are an estimated 7.4 billion people in the world.
Yes.
7.4 billion people who are connected in some form or fashion to 151,600 deaths.
That's right.
And if 7.4 billion people at some point are praying, Lord, keep them alive. I don't believe you what I'm saying.
Yes.
By the way, there are an estimated 350,000 births every day. So half the number of births, the people die every day.
Yes.
Well, who should die? What would be the criteria? How would you select it? How would you determine it if you were God? What would cause you to make it? Would you kill off the older people? Well, wouldn't that be your mother and your father? Would you kill off those that are diseased? Well, are you talking about those that have diseases that we know of? Because some of us in here right now got something that we don't know we have.
Yeah.
Now, wait a minute here. If you were God, what would be your criteria? And then he put this in my spirit. And this really kind of blew my mind. How many people today, after all of these years, how many people would still vote that George Washington be alive? Y'all not talking. At what point would you have lifted up your hand and said, I think now old Georgia boy can die? Need us to understand God and his infinite mercy and his wisdom and his understanding realizes that he does not base his decision on temporary things, because the kind of God that we serve, he is an eternal God.
Right.
I'm trying to help you understand. God ain't like man. He does not base his decision, his choices. He doesn't base it upon temporary things. But rather, he makes all of his decisions based upon his will and our own.
That's why
Jesus responds to Martha and tells her, in essence, that the reason why it is that your brother has died, he did not die because God was mad at you. He didn't die because God was mad at him. He did not die because of any other reason like that. But the reason why he died was because God was setting his own self up for the glory.
Amen.
Listen to this. Death and life must have purpose. And God's purpose is always fulfilled. This is what the Lord said to me as I talked and listened to Martha and Jesus in the text, talking back and forth. And he said to me, he said, preacher, even my only begotten son.
That's it.
And made no mistake about it. Even though he was bruised and beaten, even though I allowed him to suffer, even though I saw and knew that he was one with me and that he never strayed away from my will, even though I knew that his love for me was real and true.
That's wrong. Oh, yes. Oh, right.
Even he had a purpose in this world. He was an eternal being, born into a temporary world.
That's right.
And so I need to give you this clue. I need you to help you with this in your spirit. I need you to understand that every one of us is an eternal being.
That's right.
But we are only born for in a temporary world.
That's right.
That means I'm not here forever. You're not here forever. You were never designed to be forever. Be here forever. He only purposed you to be here for an allotted time. What I'm trying to help you to understand is, number one, God has blessed us with the opportunity called life. But then I need you to understand, don't get it twisted, that just because you are here today, don't believe you'll be here tomorrow. What you need to do is allow him to order your steps today. Allow his purpose in you to be fulfilled today. Allow him to have his way in your life today. Because for you and for me, tomorrow is not promised. You see, I allow Jesus to be born into a temporary world, but Jesus never got it twisted. He knew that he had not come here to stay, but he was only here to be about his Father's business.
Yeah.
And after he had completed his Father's business, he was going to go back to be with the Father. and gives us the opportunity to choose him, not out of obligation, but out of love. It's a wonderful and marvelous thing that God has given us the ability to interact with one another and love one another. And that's why I recommend today, church, love your family and your friends and your enemies while you have the chance. Somebody out there said and thought, surely Lazarus was going to live a long time. But at a young age, Mary and Martha saw their brother die. Sometimes you look at babies.
That's right.
They die early in life.
That's right.
Tempted to ask, Lord, why would you take such a precious gift and let them only be here for such a short season? But just because I don't know the answer doesn't mean that they have not fulfilled God's purpose.
Right.
Sometimes God may allow a child to die to remind the older people, baby, nothing is promised. Y'all pray with me over here. Sometimes God may allow children to die because he knows that they must return to him because we ain't doing right by
them. Amen.
Y'all don't want to pray with me here. God knows what he's doing. He said, I sent even my only begotten son Jesus to be born into the world just temporary. And the greatest thing that we can do while we are here is to just let God's purpose be fulfilled in our lives. Be set, make up your mind that the best that I can do is render my service to the Master.
Yes.
Because I'm not going to be here always. God said to me in the spirit, I am to eternity. But I am never obligated to the temporary.
Amen.
See, that's one of our problems. We want God.
Yeah.
We want God to be obligated to temporary things. My feelings. That's why I want God to let my relative die because I love them. I don't want to miss them. I don't want them to be absent. I want to be able to wake up and call my mama on the phone. I want to be able to turn over and see my wife laying next to me. I want to be able to call my sisters and brothers. Even though we argue like cats and dogs, I still want to be able to argue with them like cats and dogs as long as I possibly can. But I can tell you, God is not obligated to the temporary. He is only who he is.
Yes, Lord.
To the eternal, and he is eternal. God has an eternal plan. But I need you to understand, God is not after you to die. God is after you to live.
Amen.
Oh, you what I'm saying. You should have said amen loud. God is not after you to die. God is after you to live. He has come so that you can have not just life, but life more abundantly. What I'm trying to help you to understand is that as long as you're on this, that's about the spirit rejoicing on the inside. For you to be able to say it's well with my soul, even if I lose some things, if I lose a car, if I lose a job, if I lose a home, if I lose the money, it's still well with my soul because I am loud as I got King Jesus. There ain't nobody else. Then as I listen to Martha talking to Jesus,
yes,
the Lord told me in my spirit, like some of us, we believe that folk belong to us. That's my mother. That's my father. That's my sister. That's my brother. That's my husband. That's my wife. But I heard a preacher say one time, the Lord told him, that's not your members, those are mine.
Yeah.
Sometimes I have to let the Lord correct me in my spirit when I start thinking about the members that I have left, that I have lost. Then he reminds me, I have never lost anything.
Then he said to the proof to you,
let me remind you, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The worlds and they that dwell therein, it all belongs to the Lord. And that's what I'm trying to help you to understand. Learn how to just realize that it never was yours in the first place. It was God, and God entrusted them into your care. God gave you the opportunity to cry with them, to pray with them, to laugh with them, to argue with them, to love them, to kiss them, and to let them know that you really care. You know, here's a very sad realization to me. Am I the only one that has lost too much time? Times I've been sitting there fussing with my mama.
All
right.
Oh, Lord. Times when I stood there fighting with my sisters and my brothers. The times when I sit there and roll my eyes behind my father's back. Notice I said. Behind his back.
Yes.
I could have humbled myself and realized that those things that we were arguing about were temporary, and I should have been building on the eternity of God. I should have been loving while I had the chance. And for some of you, I need to let you know today, you need to take this message and run with it, because there's some people still living in your life that you need to go through and say, baby, listen, all of that other stuff ain't important. I just want you to know today, I called you not to continue to argue with you, but I called to tell you, I love you.
Amen.
Thank God. I still got some loved ones. That today I could call on the telephone and say, you know, I was in church today and the Lord spoke to me and told me that I need to put down this foolish stuff and put these temporary things to the side. I don't care about what we've been arguing about. What I care about is that we have been separated in our relationship. And today I came to say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Tell you I love you. God will let fall down.
Oh yes.
To remind you of how you've been.
Yes.
At him.
Oh, yes.
How you've been talking.
Yes.
How you've been living your life.
Yes.
And then the Lord told me, always remember that death and life are my discretion. I am the one that decides who lives and who dies. No, you don't, you didn't hear what I'm saying, so I need to break it down to you so you know what I'm talking about. A lot of you get scared by the enemy into believing, because the devil came with some bad news, that's the final word. Sickness, disease, disaster, none of these things determine life or death.
All right.
No doctor in a white coat,
right.
No medicine in a brown body. None of these things are going to decide whether or not you stay on this side or not.
Amen.
Touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you better trust in the Lord.
Amen.
He had to become an expert at breaking down your faith.
Oh, yes.
don't you listen to him when he tells you that God has left him. Don't ever allow him to tell you that death is the end. Death is never the end. It's only the beginning of your eternity. You believe what I'm saying? Then sometimes we believe when the devil comes up to us and he tells us, now that Lazarus is dead, your life is over.
Yeah.
When you lost your mother, suddenly your world changed.
Yeah.
Now your life is over. I need you to understand, your life was never based upon your mother.
Amen.
Your life was never based upon your father.
Amen.
Your joy should have never been built around your wife, nor your husband.
Amen.
I heard Job say one time, naked I came into the world. Because somebody came with some bad news to tell you you're going to die. But I need you to understand that only God determines who lives and who dies.
And
then I need you to know that those that die in the Lord, they shall reap a handsome reward. Jesus said at one time, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I'm going to come back to receive you unto myself. Then I heard what he said in my Father's house. And there are many mansions. He said, if it were not so, I would not have told you so. What he's trying to say is that those that die in the Lord, whether they be you or me, whether it be Lazarus or somebody else, if you die in the Lord, then you have a reward. You know, the Lord told me, Ella, listen to Mary, to Martha and Jesus. He said, preacher, Lazarus shall arise again. But I need you to know in here this morning,
yes, Lord,
that there have been many in the grave who have died in the Lord. Mothers and fathers, sisters and brothers, who have closed their eyes on the side and have laid their foot in the sands of time.
Yes, sir.
My father would say, tell my son that he needs to press for the mark of the high calling through Jesus Christ. Yeah. But tell him that I've already run my race. Oh, Lord, I finished my course. One day after Christmas, Lord, call my name. Yeah. And while none of his children were ready to tell Father goodbye, oh Lord, I hear him tell me now that when the father died, he did not object to the Lord.
Father,
that died in the Lord.
Yes.
Your sister, through Jesus Christ.
Boy.
The love. And then you know this. Because you know, the day came.
Yes.
Even after Lazarus was brought back from the dead.
Yes.
Lazarus died again.
Yes,
not because God was mad. But how many know at some point God moved all of his children close. He is tired of seeing them in pain.
Yes.
He becomes weary of them crying and struggling and suffering. Sometimes God says, I know that the family won't understand.
Yes.
I know somebody still want to hold on. So enough. But enough is enough. And I need you to know one of these days, God's going to tell you, enough. Is enough. And then at that moment, it won't matter how many people pray for you. At that moment, it won't matter how many people are still holding on saying, please don't give up. When the Lord calls your name, you got to answer. And when you die in the Lord, I ain't going to hurt nobody's feelings. Around the throne.
All
right. Looking back over this side and saying, Lord, send me back to my first born.
Be ready.
Let the